Despite being in the Tsaritsa bunker, which was far stronger than Krylov's dirt dugout had been on Mamaev Kurgan, the 62nd Army Command Post was being hit by artillery and mortar fire. Worse, machine gun bullets were also pinging off the bunker at this point too. So, getting permission from Eremenko first, Chuikov and his staff decided to withdraw their headquarters overnight on the 15th to 16th of September 1942. Isaev points out that, while Chuikov did say in his memoirs that he only withdrew on the next evening, this is because the headquarters moved in two lots. Chuikov himself, though, moved this evening. They crossed to the eastern bank of the Volga with shells whizzing over their heads, so another near miss for Chuikov there. Then Chuikov had a bath, got changed into new clothes, had breakfast and a cup of tea, then realised that the sun was coming up and that he was about to miss the last ferry across the Volga. In a panic, Chuikov raced up the Volga to another crossing point in the north. The thought leaped into my mind that the last boat was leaving, and that we would have to spend the whole day on the left bank of the Volga. What might happen to the army, to the city, during the day? My hair stood on end. I rushed to the landing stage. The boat had already begun to move away. Summoning every ounce of energy, I leaped straight for the boat. It worked. I was on the boat. Gurov was running towards the landing stage. I shouted to the man at the wheel to turn back. 10 minutes later, Chuikov arrived at the Volga's western bank, east of the Red October steel works. From here, he moved north to the bank behind the Barricades factory. 62nd Army Headquarters was set up in the open, in hastily dug trenches, or on barges on the Volga, while sappers started working on a more permanent position. Oh, and someone told them not to worry about the fuel tanks. They were empty. Also that morning, the 1st and 2nd Battalions of 39th Guards Rifle Regiment landed near the Red October factory. They marched to the Mamaev Kurgan area, arriving in time to launch a joint attack at 0900 hours with one shattered regiment of just 120 men from the 112th Rifle Division. There was a brief 10-minute artillery bombardment. Then the men sneaked up a gully towards the summit. But the Germans spotted them and fired back. Still, the Soviets weren't worried. They'd been told that they'd be receiving reinforcements from a tank brigade. And here it came, the tank brigade had arrived. Except, instead of a full brigade, there were only four tanks, maybe five, all fresh from the factory workshops. They all became immobilized within minutes, with two being knocked out completely, and the rest withdrew. Then they realized that their artillery was inaccurate, and the Luftwaffe had appeared, and the German mortars and artillery rained down upon them, and so the attack fumbled. Which is why Rodimtsev himself had to step in to rally his wavering troops. I saw a young lieutenant who had frozen in terror. I told him to move his men forward, but he seemed oblivious to my command. I had never hit a soldier under my command, and I never wanted to again. But I grabbed hold of that lieutenant, shook him hard, slapped him twice across the face, and yelled, "Get going!" Suddenly, he woke up, pulled himself together, and sprinted forward, followed by his men. He won a medal for courage that day. What is it with generals slapping their troops? I'm beginning to see a pattern developing here. Anyway, the attack continued and another German machine gunner opened up. That was when a 19-year-old Anatoly Ivanovich Chekhov scored his first two kills. When I first got the rifle, I couldn't bring myself to kill another being. One German was standing there for about 4 minutes talking, and I let him go. When I killed my first one, he fell at once. Another one ran out and stooped over the killed one, and I knocked him down too. When I first killed, I was shaking all over. The man was only walking to get some water. I felt scared. I had killed a person. The tide of battle turned when the guardsmen finally got close enough to the German lines. 2nd Guards Battalion's commander, Captain Kirik, personally led his attack against one German position. Another lieutenant threw grenades at one German machine gun position, killing five Germans, before capturing the gun and using it against the Germans in turn. And because the distance had been closed, Luftwaffe pilots were concerned that they might hit their own men, so they dropped their bombs too far behind the Soviet lines to do much damage. The same thing happened with the artillery. Thus, after a bitter struggle, a Soviet flag was hoisted on Mamaev Kurgan at 1100 hours. Guardsman Kintier achieved fame by tearing down the German flag erected at the summit by soldiers of the 295th Infantry Division and trampling on it. But it was not all heroics. There are accounts of some of the Soviet soldiers from the 112th Rifle Division giving up and surrendering to the Germans. Given the intensity of the fighting, this is understandable. And while some of the accounts say that Mamaev Kurgan remained in Soviet hands and was never lost again, this is doubtful. The Germans may have retaken the hill in the early afternoon, and then lost it again to the Soviets, who took it back at 1300 hours, 1350 hours, 1500 hours, and then again at 1630 hours. Some German reports deny that the Soviet attacks took the hill at all, while others say that if they did, they were quickly beaten back. And overall, the accounts are conflicting, probably because the hill kept changing hands over and over. Thereafter, although both sides would claim control of Mamaev Kurgan, in fact, the two antagonists shared the hill, fighting desperately along the burial mound slopes for days over control of the prize. As the slopes of Hill 102 changed hands over and over, further north, the 506th and 517th Infantry Regiments of Wuttmann's 295th Infantry Division grinded their way forwards against numerous Soviet units. Stretched thin as they were, though, they didn't get very far. South of these positions and of Mamaev Kurgan, the battle raged in the city centre. A confusing close combat melee of small arms and rifle butts boiled in the area, making it difficult to figure out exactly what happened, or even where the front line was. In some places there wasn't a front line at all, because units of both sides were so intermingled. For example, the 1st Battalion of the 34th Guards Rifle Regiment managed to push forward to the railway line, clearing the Germans from the area. But it appears that the 1st Battalion of the 518th Infantry Regiment moved behind it into the two ravines. Here the Germans clashed with the two southern regiments of 112th Rifle Division, who were near the Volga but were also trying to inch forwards. The 2nd Battalion of the 34th Guards Regiment was also moving towards the railway line, although its southern wing was bogged down by German resistance. They did manage to take the L-shaped house though, while the fighting continued in and around the 9th of January Square, the Gossbank, and the Houses of Specialists. This picture was from the 16th of September 1942. It shows the 194th Infantry Regiment plus Stugs from the 244th Sturmgeschütz Battalion on Kursk Street. The building in the background is one of the Houses of Specialists. So, to put this on the map, here is Kursk Street, and here is the Houses of Specialists. So the picture was taken looking towards the Volga, probably about here. Speaking of Stugs, at some point in this combat, Hauptmann Lutz leant out of his Sturmgeschütz to see what was happening, and was shot by a Soviet rifleman, who killed him. Nearby, the 3rd Battalion of the 34th Guards Rifle Regiment moved to the area near Fallen Fighters Square. The 1st Battalion of the 42nd Guards Rifle Regiment continued to resist around the central train station, although the station itself, the carriages and the platforms, changed hands several times. For now though, Dragon's men, reinforced by a machine gun company and with 3rd Company in support, still commanded the area. West of these actions, in the Zapolonovsky district, 11-year-old Natasha Kornilov and her mother feared that the Germans would rape them. So, to put them off, they wrote the word typhus on a board and pinned it to their front door. The plan backfired though, because the German medic saw that the house was plagued and decided to burn the house down to extinguish the disease. Natasha and her mother had to escape the flames and spent the evening in their shed, listening to gunfire going on nearby. Further south by this point, 48th Panzer Corps had been officially subordinated to the 6th Army, although would still receive supplies from the 4th Panzer Army. That said, 6th Army's diary notes that the 48th Panzer Corps only had 100 rounds left for its 10cm artillery, and the Army's quartermaster had to send their remaining stocks from 6th Army to them. Clearly, the supply situation for Axis forces in and around Stalingrad was desperate already. Now under Paulus' control, 24th Panzer and 94th Infantry Divisions were given the task of reaching the southern bank of the Tsaritsa by the end of the day. The Soviet forces opposing them sat in strong points throughout the area, but there wasn't a solid line, meaning that these positions could potentially be bypassed, isolated, and destroyed. That said, 24th Panzer Division hadn't formed a solid line along the railway, and overnight most of 10th Rifle Brigade had infiltrated through and taken up positions in the grain elevator area. Thus, at dawn, Pfeiffer's 94th Infantry Division pushed through the north of the Menina suburb, forcing back the 133rd Tank Brigade, 271st NKVD Rifle Regiment, and the 35th Guards Rifle Division. As part of this effort was an anti-aircraft battery that combed the ruins of Menina for Soviet resistance. The soldier in the foreground with the binoculars and MP40 submachine gun was Senior Lieutenant Helmut Schnatz. And here is a more famous picture of the same unit. The grain elevator can be seen poking above the ruins in the background. Pfeiffer's grenadiers moved through the Menina suburbs and just before noon crossed the Yelshanka River. It was there, in the gullies and from the railway embankment, that they encountered stiff resistance, as the Soviet troops now decided to stand their ground. 94th Infantry Division did manage to push the Soviets back into the food combine and grain elevator, but their attack bogged down in the late afternoon. September 16th, our battalion plus tanks is attacking the grain elevator, from which smoke is pouring. The grain in it is burning. The Russians seem to have set light to it themselves. Barbarism. The battalion is suffering heavy losses. There are not more than 60 men left in each company. The elevator is occupied not by men, but by devils, that no flame or bullets can destroy. Well, it appears that bullets could kill the Soviets, or at least harm them enough for the Germans to take and occupy the elevator at this time. Yes, for a short time, the grain elevator was in German hands, which is contrary to some of the other accounts. But 94th Infantry Division wasn't able to reach the Tsaritsa. This failure left 24th Panzer Division's right flank exposed as Kampfgruppe Idelsheim moved north along the railway line, fighting elements of Bakhtrakov's 42nd Naval Rifle Brigade in the process. They captured the railway bridge and formed a small bridgehead across the Tsaritsa River, effectively encircling the Soviet forces in the west. This was clearly a bad situation for the Soviets. However, because of stiff resistance, including several Soviet tanks facing German units at the barracks, Idelsheim was compelled to send a panzer and infantry Kampfgruppe to reinforce Hellermann. On the one hand, this action scattered the 10th Rifle Brigade's remnants in the west, and allowed the Germans to capture the barracks area and most of the Dargora district from 244th Rifle Division. But it also meant that Idelsheim was left in an extremely vulnerable position, and at midday, 42nd Rifle Brigade and NKVD troops assaulted Idelsheim's bridgehead on the Tsaritsa River from all sides. After Hellermann tried but failed to reach the Tsaritsa and reinforce Idelsheim's forces, the latter had no choice but to abandon the bridgehead shortly after sunset. Lenski's tank strength by this point had fallen to just 21 operational panzers with 2 command tanks and 7 Panzer IIs. Idelsheim was therefore compelled to withdraw, providing the Soviets in the west a chance to break out of their pocket. The Germans still commanded the area, and their fire positions could target any Soviet riflemen trying to escape from the west. So the question is, could they break out of the trap? Let's find out. Fremery's 29th Motorized Division was faced with the remnants of Dubiansky's 35th Guards Rifle Division and 2 regiments of Peshoshin's 131st Rifle Division, which held out in several strong points south of the Yelshanka River. Fremery struggled to clear the area and barely reached the Yelshanka River by the end of the day. Still, the advance in the south had been decisive enough to shatter several Soviet units and take a sizeable amount of ground. The famous photo of these two German submachine gunners in a bomb crater was taken around this time. Thanks to Igor Kobyakov, whose super in-depth articles you can read for yourself if you click the link in the description, I can now locate this on the map. Here is the second photo from the same crater where Igor has highlighted the train station in the background. This means that the photo was taken somewhere around here, looking this way, towards the station buildings. Nearby, in the Dargora district, 15-year-old Saka Filipov introduced himself to some German officers and offered his services as a cobbler. The Germans accepted, and Saka got to work. And yes, this scene, unlike the others, from the film Enemy the Gates, appears to be true. Anyway, after a hard day of fighting, the only real progress for either side was made in the south, with the Germans on this line at the start of the day, and here by the end of it. While the Germans had been pushed back at Mamaev Kurgan, they were still on the hill and were contesting it, and the centre of the battlefield hadn't resulted in much of a difference. 13th Guards Rifle Division had suffered 162 men killed, and 446 wounded on the 16th. In contrast, the 71st Infantry Division reported the loss of 11 men killed, 50 wounded, and 10 men missing. The 295th Infantry Division lost 39 men killed, 161 wounded, and 9 missing, suggesting that the fighting for the centre of Stalingrad and for Mamaev Kurgan had been brutal for both sides, although more so for the Soviets. This report sums up the terrible situation in 13th Guards Rifle Division's area. The matter of transporting wounded to the left bank of the Volga is very bad. The commander of 13th Guards Rifle Division has no means whatsoever for transporting the wounded. The lightly wounded soldiers are building rafts for themselves, carrying the seriously wounded on them, and while crossing to the left bank are easily carried by the currents along the river, where they disperse into the villages and search for help. Perhaps more concerning to Zhukov, the 13th Guards still has not received ammunition and artillery at midnight on 16th September. Some have suggested that Paulus' main tactical mistake was not having the Luftwaffe concentrate on stopping supplies coming across the Volga. Doing this could have choked the 62nd Army out of existence. Well, for starters, it was Richthofen who was in charge of the Luftwaffe, not Paulus, and Richthofen seemed to think that bombing Stalingrad was more important than the river crossings. Secondly, the Germans knew from experience that trying to attack ships from the air wasn't practical, especially because of the small size of the boats on the Volga, so it made sense to hit land targets instead. Finally, for the most part, the boats that crossed the Volga crossed at night, and it was difficult enough to attack the boats in broad daylight, let alone hit them at night. So this criticism of Paulus, which does sound good in theory, doesn't really work in practice. That said, being restricted to shifting supplies across the river at night did cause supply problems, and this added to the pressure placed on Dragon's 1st Company, who were sat in Stalingrad Central Railway Station, being bombed by the Luftwaffe. Incendiaries set fire to the station itself, and the company lost a lot of men to fire and smoke. According to Dragon, the Germans moved through the fountain area and into the nail factory, hoping to encircle them. A wild fight ensued, and Dragon had to launch a counterattack with his whole company to retake portions of the nail factory. As the fighting died down, the Soviets held one of the workshops while the Germans occupied the other, but probably due to the fire and the smoke, plus the need to mount this counterattack, the shattered remnants of Dragon's company and the other reinforcements were forced to fall back from the station overnight on the 16th to 17th of September. This fact will probably annoy some people, because the traditional version of events, with people like Zhukov, other eyewitnesses, and even several historians from the West all supporting this, claims that the brave men of 1st Company held out for 5 to 10 days in the central train station. Sorry, it didn't happen. Rather than the train station, it was in the nail factory that Dragon's company continued to hold out, along with the rest of 1st Battalion. But they still held on, just not in the station. And 3rd Company was down to 20 men at this point, so Dragon's company was probably not faring much better. And the fighting around here was certainly not over. There's there's more to come. So there's no need to be upset, the Soviets were still heroically holding on. A couple of days previously, on the 14th of September, Wietersheim proposed to Paulus, again, that they should withdraw from the Volga and that they should take up defensive positions rather than send tanks into the city of Stalingrad. According to Colonel Adam, Wietersheim didn't believe that Stalingrad could be taken, and this frustrated both Paulus and the High Command. Glantz says that he annoyed the Führer himself. Thus, the German High Command gave Colonel Adam a letter, and he went to deliver it to Wietersheim. Wietersheim had doubts about success. Such an attitude seemed unbearable to Paulus, who was of the opinion that the two attacking armies would still take the city. Wietersheim lost his command and was replaced on the 16th by Hans Huber from 16th Panzer Division. In turn, Huber was replaced by General Angern. This seems a little harsh on Wietersheim though, since his force had been stopped by Zhukov's Kotluban Offensive more than anything else, and had survived an encirclement for a while during late August and early September. It was also strange to select Huber as his replacement, since Huber had also wanted to withdraw from the Volga. Plus, as Colonel Adam makes clear, the Chief of Staff for 14th Panzer Corps also wanted to withdraw. So why wasn't he sacked too? Maybe Wietersheim's relief had more to do with his previous argument with the Führer in 1938. What's also interesting is that Paulus himself seems to have been troubled with doubts about success at Stalingrad. According to Craig,
in his stifling quarters, the general played his gramophone, smoked endless quantities of cigarettes, and tried to calm his stomach, which was churning with dysentery. He had lost most of his hopes for a quick victory. Regardless of the problems in the north, or with German doubts of victory, the Soviets were also in trouble in the city. Having taken over a command of an army that was depleted as a result of the previous fighting, and was currently suffering horrendous losses, Chuikov appealed for more reinforcements from Eremenko. He stated that the 13th Guards Rifle Division was in trouble, that his army was bleeding to death, and was on the brink of being annihilated. He asked for two or three full rifle divisions, but Eremenko only promised him the 92nd Naval Rifle Brigade and the 137th Tank Brigade, which had just 15 T-60s at this time. This didn't bode well for Chuikov. On the 17th of September 1942, the 389th Infantry Division was unable to advance in its sector, seemingly stopped by the Soviets ahead of them. The 295th Infantry Division, however, continued to push eastward, gaining ground slowly against several Soviet units. Still, Mamaev Kurgan continued to be contested, with neither side able to secure the entire hill. The 13th Guards Rifle Division's diary boasts of bravely holding on to the dear city which bears the name of the great Stalin, and repelling six German attacks on the Kurgan. This might be true, but there's no way to tell, and the battle was a stalemate regardless of what happened. At the Dolgi and Krutoi ravines, the 112th Rifle Division's 385th and 524th Regiments cleared a small amount of ground ahead of them, while at the same time, the 6th Army mistakenly recorded that they had cleared the ravines of Soviet forces. This suggests that there was a confusing struggle for both ravines. At the same time, 9th of January Square remained in neither side's hands, and the specialist buildings and the NKVD buildings were still contested, remaining in German hands. Some authors report that the railway station swapped hands four or more times, with both sides claiming that they'd taken it by the end of the day. The problem is that Dragon's account refutes this, because his company had already abandoned the station by this point. Having fallen back from the station, Dragon's men continued to hold out in the nail factory, with Germans in the next room, while being attacked from three sides. They were out of water, and so they shot at drain pipes, hoping to find more. They'd also gone a while without food or sleep, and their ammunition and strength was running out, so the situation was becoming increasingly urgent.
Now, you may also recall that 1st Battalion's commander had supposedly been wounded in the fight for the central train station on the 15th of September, and then was replaced by his deputy, Senior Lieutenant Fedosiev. But, according to 1st Company's commander, Dragon, what really happened was that Shervyakov was relieved of command on the 17th because he was suffering from shell shock. Fedosiev therefore took over command of the remnants of the battalion, and this account makes sense not only because it's from someone who was actually there and saw what happened, but also because it's easy to imagine that the Soviet authorities wouldn't want to admit that the brave defenders of the station were commanded by someone who lost his nerve, especially since the official narrative claimed that they held onto the station for 5 to 10 days when in reality they had already lost it. That would be a bitter pill to swallow, so it's more likely that the story got changed to say he was wounded.
Nonetheless, the fighting around the nail factory, Red Square, and the department store raged on. 42nd Guards Regiment's commander, Yelin, reported that 8 destroyed German tanks and 100 bodies of German soldiers lay around the station. Perhaps more concerning, the 211th Infantry Regiment, with elements of 194th, moved south and took almost all of the buildings and streets west of the main railroad line by the end of the day. With the advance in the south, this was a major problem for the Soviets. Because 48th Panzer Corps' 24th Panzer and 94th Infantry Divisions resumed their offensive against 244th Rifle Division, 10th Rifle, and 133rd Tank Brigades. Shortly before dawn, 1st and 2nd Battalions of 26th Grenadier Regiment of Kampfgruppe Idelsheim advanced northwest from the train line, clearing out the streets west of the railroad by 11:20 hours. Kampfgruppe Hellermann, the 40th Panzerjäger Battalion, and the 4th Motorcycle Battalion moved north from the barracks and took the hilly area south of the Tsaritsa Balka by noon. In the process, 40th Panzerjäger Battalion not only destroyed 5 Soviet tanks, but also captured a T-34, which they then started to use for themselves. Found in the barracks area of Group Hellermann were 46 Russian tanks, among them 23 T-34s, all destroyed by German weapons. Their advance drove Soviet forces in the region northwards towards the Tsaritsa Balka. Then, Kampfgruppe Hellermann linked up with 71st Infantry Division's 211th Regiment, but Hellermann couldn't clear the gullies ahead of them, where the Soviet remnants clung on desperately. The pressure forced Soviet stragglers to filter down the Tsaritsa towards the Volga, or even through Idelsheim's dotted lines. Fremery's 29th Motorized Division's advance had slowed to a crawl in the area north of the lumber factory and the power plant. The remaining 150 men of Dubyansky's 35th Guards Rifle Division, the 100 men of 131st Rifle Division, and some policemen from 271st NKVD Regiment were mostly forced back across the Elshanka, although some elements held onto a few houses just south of the river. Pfeiffer's 94th Infantry Division tried to keep pace with 24th Panzer Division's Panzergrenadiers, fighting with Soviet troops east of the railroad line. Soviet resistance was tough in this area though. A single battalion from the 267th Regiment was able to push north up the railroad line and link with Kampfgruppe Idelsheim at the Tsaritsa bridgehead. Otherwise, the 274th Regiment continued to fight for the grain elevator and other buildings east of the railroad. The 276th Regiment managed to take the bridge over the Elshanka, but couldn't make progress against the cannery buildings. Here is another photo showing soldiers from the 94th Infantry Division at the train lines near the elevator. Igor Kobryakov notes that the elevator's face hasn't been destroyed yet, so the picture was probably taken on the 17th or the 18th of September. If you haven't already, check out Kobryakov's articles because he shows a lot more pictures than this, and maps as well. Plus, his articles are very detailed, so again, link in the description. At 1800 hours, Senior Lieutenant Polyakov created a detachment of about 27 men from his combined battalion from the 10th Rifle Brigade, and split this into 3 smaller groups. As one of them offered suppressing fire, the other 2 hit the German garrison of the grain elevator on the flanks and stormed the silo. They managed to take the ground floor, but the second floor remained in German hands for now. Losing part of the elevator plus the stubborn resistance throughout this area caused the German attack to stall. But 94th Infantry Division's advance had allowed 24th Panzer Division's lines along the railroad to solidify by the end of the day, meaning that the remaining positions of the Soviet forces to the west had only one escape route open to them, and that was down the Tsaritsa Balka itself. The question is, could they make it to safety?
Paulus and Kempf now visited the commanders of both the 94th Infantry and the 29th Motorized Divisions. By this point, Fremery's few remaining panzers, all nine of them, were so worn out that they needed complete overhauls. And with Paulus's and Kempf's visit, this gave Fremery the opportunity to explain the trouble his men were having, and also how bad his division was suffering. From Paulus's report, "The divisional commander, Fremery, stresses the heavy losses in personnel and officers." Plus, Kempf had warned him about the critical ammunition situation, so if Paulus hadn't realised how bad the state of his divisions were before this, he definitely knew it now. The actions of 48th Panzer Corps on this day had created a dilemma. Kempf had ordered the 24th Panzer Division to clear the Tsaritsa Balka of Soviet resistance, but interestingly, Lenski proposed that they ignore the Tsaritsa pocket and instead concentrate against Soviet forces in the grain elevator area. This is the problem we discussed last time. Why didn't 24th Panzer Division take the grain elevator and cannery area rather than race off towards the Tsaritsa Balka? If they had done this, they could have trapped Soviet forces in the south and destroyed them first, before moving against the 244th Rifle Division and 42nd Naval Rifle Brigade. And it seems that from Lenski's perspective, he thought that this area along the Volga was more important than trying to solve the issue to the northwest. But from Kemp's perspective, the pocket was more important than the Volga area. A little bit of speculation, but this might be because Kempf had been told that 71st Infantry Division needed support in the center of Stalingrad, something that Lenski wouldn't have known. At the same time, as though the Balka wasn't really important, that evening the 191st Infantry Regiment wheeled eastwards behind the 211th Infantry Regiment to join the 194th Infantry Regiment in the struggle for the center of Stalingrad. Why didn't they help clear the pocket? Why did they leave it to 24th Panzer Division? It was probably because the Germans were stretched thin throughout Stalingrad, and the priority was to help the 194th Infantry Regiment, which was under a lot of pressure in the center of the city. Here are the losses for some of the units on the 17th of September. It's not clear what casualties the other formations took, but it was undoubtedly more than the Germans, simply because of their dominance of air and artillery at this time. Losses for the whole of 51st Army Corps since the start of the city fight on the 13th are as shown. In just 4 days, they'd suffered a lot of casualties, although it must be said that this wasn't significantly different from the losses they were typically receiving prior to the battle, suggesting that German divisions were bleeding before they reached the city, and just continued to hemorrhage blood once they were in it. And rather than German divisions drowning under a sea of Russian riflemen, the diary of 13th Guards Rifle Division says it was the Germans who "broke like waves on granite rocks before the truly hard determination of our soldiers and commanders." Looks like both sides indulged in propaganda metaphors on the Eastern Front. 24th Panzer Division lost 2 men killed and 37 wounded, although 14 of these stayed with the troops. But while they had captured about 300 Soviet prisoners, their division was getting increasingly weak, as were the other German divisions. The Leaping Horsemen were down to just 23 panzers, 7 of which were Panzer IIs, although they had gained 1 T-34, bringing their total to 24 tanks. Lenski also reported to Kempf that there was a critical shortage of ammunition for his infantry guns, howitzers, anti-tank shells and flak guns. By this point, the division had entirely run out of 20mm flak gun shells, which they'd been using in the anti-tank and anti-personnel roles.
Unlike the Germans, there was some good news for Chuikov. That evening, as promised by Eremenko, the 137th Tank and 92nd Naval Rifle Brigades were shipped across the Volga. Udovichenko's tanks concentrated in the area east of Mamaev Kurgan to back up the Soviet forces there. And Chuikov sent Tarasov's brigade into action between the Tsaritsa and the Yelshanka rivers. Chuikov then reorganized his southern forces. The remnants of the shattered formations here were reformed into either Tarasov's 92nd Rifle Brigade or Dubyansky's 35th Guards Rifle Division. It was hoped that this would unify the men under two commanders, making them easier to control, although in reality the remnants were all mixed together in a disorganized soup. In addition, Afanasyev's division merged with Bakhtrakov's brigade, and this group was tasked with linking up with Tarasov's 92nd Rifle Brigade, who would be attacking towards them and trying to break through to them. In addition to these developments, the Stavka also released the reformed 193rd Rifle Division and sent it to Yeremenko's southeastern front. And the 95th and 284th Rifle Divisions were also en route to Stalingrad at this time. So the Soviets were making moves to improve the situation in Stalingrad at the same time that the German outlook was looking increasingly gloomy. But perhaps for the Germans, the most concerning thing was this. On the 17th of September, the temperature dropped suddenly. Men put on woolen garments under their jackets, which were in most cases disintegrating already. The soldiers' clothing, noted one doctor, was so worn out that frequently they were obliged to wear items of Russian uniform. Several days earlier, Zhukov had instructed Yeremenko to plan another offensive in the Kotluban region. This would be the Stalingrad Front's third attack to the north of the city of Stalingrad, although technically it would be the second Kotluban offensive. While the Soviet leadership thought that their enemy was weakening, Yeremenko believed that the reason the previous attacks had failed was because they had gone up against 14th Panzer Corps. Therefore, he decided that this time it was best to strike the infantry divisions of 8th Army Corps slightly to the west. While it would increase the distance from the 62nd Army, Yeremenko believed that if he struck the seam between the two German corps, only defended by one regiment and three battalions at this time, then he would have a greater chance of success. But instead of just reinforcing the 24th Army, Yeremenko ordered that the 24th and 1st Guards armies were to swap positions. It's not exactly clear why he decided to do this. Maybe he thought Moskalenko was the better man for the job. But either way, only the army headquarters swapped places, not the divisions. To avoid a major shift of forces, which the Germans would certainly have identified as preparations for a new Soviet offensive, Yeremenko directed Kozlov and Moskalenko to exchange divisions and their sectors, rather than move their forces laterally across the front. So, during a brief period of just 3 days with a huge amount of problems to overcome, Moskalenko somehow turned all of his divisions over to the 66th and 24th Armies, moved his command post to the Kotluban Station region, and integrated 24th Army's divisions into his own army. Then Yeremenko ordered that the flanks of these two armies should be taken over by the 66th and 4th Tank Armies to narrow the area of operations for the upcoming offensive. But Moskalenko's new divisions weren't up for the job. None of them were at full strength, and none of them were fully rested. Now, yes, he received several new divisions as reinforcement, but many of these weren't new. They had just been pulled out of the line in other sectors. There was a lack of mortars, machine guns, and other equipment in most of these divisions. All the rest were depleted and received few replacements. All three of Moskalenko's tank corps had suffered heavy losses during the previous offensive, and half of their tanks were light models. Moskalenko did get some reinforcements, especially from 10 artillery regiments and 8 Guards Katyusha rocket regiments, which were a welcome addition, but while Moskalenko's army had a total paper strength of 123,882 men and 340 tanks, not all of these would be committed to the attack. The assault force would consist of 86,000 men and probably 170 tanks. Moskalenka's goal was to strike the 60th Motorized Division's left wing west of the railroad line at 564 Station, then break through towards the Orlovka area and the rear of the 51st Army Corps. The main focus was on his right flank with the 258th and 173rd Rifle Divisions. They were ordered to defeat 76th Infantry Division's right wing on their own. But they might be reinforced by Kravchenka's 4th Tank Corps and the worn-out 221st and 207th Rifle Divisions, if they were needed. In reserve, he had Maslov's 16th Tank Corps and the 260th Rifle Division, again only to join in if needed. On Moskalenka's left, Kozlov's 24th Army would also attack 60th Motorized Division's forces east of 564th Kilometer Station, while Malinovsky's 66th Army was to strike the boundary of 16th Panzer and 3rd Motorized Divisions to distract German attention away from the main effort. Yeremenko committed all of his artillery from both of his fronts, as well as all of 8th Air Army's aircraft and 16th Air Army too. He also decided that the 62nd and 64th Armies should attack as well to distract the Germans and catch them off guard. If Chuikov attacked with Group Gorokhov striking northwest from the city at the same time as he launched attacks from the Red October village, as Shumilov's army attacked south of Stalingrad with the aim of linking up with Chuikov's army in the city, then this could distract the Germans enough for the second Kotluban offensive to work. This all appeared great on paper, but the paper didn't tell the full story. The Soviet 8th Air Army only had 123 aircraft to help out with this attack, which would be significantly outnumbered by the Germans. Worse, 1st Guards Army was attacking on too narrow a front, hampering its deployment, and it would get practically zero support from either the 62nd or 64th Armies. Worse, the assault would start in broad daylight, which would mean the Luftwaffe would be all over them. The idea of moving the headquarters and not the armies was meant to gain the elements of surprise, but it didn't work. From about the 15th or 16th of September, the Germans had noticed the Soviet build-up, so they weren't surprised at all. Worse, while Moskalenka's army would only face a German force of roughly 6,000 men with no armoured vehicles, and Yeremenko's three armies in total outnumbered the defenders by 6-1 in manpower and 5-1 in tanks, the Germans were in an extensive strongpoint defence system consisting of bunkers and dugouts protected by obstacles and had ample Luftwaffe support. The Germans had also transferred the 177th Sturmgeschütz Battalion to the area, knowing that the Soviets would attack, and thus had an additional 14 Stugs at the ready. So things were going wrong even before the attack had started, and the paper strength of each side didn't tell the full story. Thus, even before the attack had begun, the result was predictable, a poorly coordinated operation that wasted the bravery of the soldiers and the production of the armaments factories. Yeremenko was rushing into an operation with understrength formations manned by exhausted or inexperienced troops. But considering the situation for Chuikov in Stalingrad, it was worth trying. The attack would go in on the 18th. Could it work? Could the Soviets break through to Chuikov? We'll find out next time. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.